This is the first of four programs in which I want to question some of the assumptions usually made about the tradition of European painting. That tradition which was born about 1400, died about 1900. Tonight, it isn't so much the paintings themselves which I want to consider, as the way we now see them, now in the second half of the 20th century. Because we see these paintings as nobody saw them before. If we discover why this is so, we shall also discover something about ourselves and the situation in which we are living. The process of seeing paintings, or seeing anything else, is less spontaneous and natural than we tend to believe. A large part of seeing depends upon habit and convention. All the paintings of the tradition used the convention of perspective, which is unique to European art. Now, perspective centers everything on the eye of the beholder. It is like a beam from a lighthouse, only instead of light traveling outwards, appearances travel in, and our tradition of art called those appearances reality. Perspective makes the eye the center of the visible world. But the human eye can only be in one place at a time. It takes its visible world with it as it walks. With the invention of the camera, everything changed. We could see things which were not there in front of us. Appearances could travel across the world. It was no longer so easy to think of appearances always traveling regularly to a single center.
I am an eye, a mechanical eye. I, the machine, show your world the way only I can see it. I free myself for today and forever from human immobility. I'm in constant movement. I approach and pull away from objects. I creep under them. I move alongside a running horse's mouth. I fall and rise with the falling and rising bodies. This is I, the machine, maneuvering in the chaotic movements, recording one movement after another in the most complex combinations. Freed from the boundaries of time and space, I coordinate any and all points of the universe wherever I want them to be. My way leads towards the creation of a fresh perception of the world. Thus I explain, in a new way, the world unknown to you.
Those words are from a manifesto written in 1923 by Ziger Vertov, the Russian film director. And the images are from a film he made in 1928 called The Man with a Movie Camera. The invention of the camera has changed not only what we see, but how we see it. And in a crucial but quite simple way, it has even changed paintings painted long before it was invented. The painting on the wall, like a human eye, can only be in one place at one time. The camera reproduces it, making it available in any size, anywhere, for any purpose. Botticelli's Venus and Mars used to be a unique image, which it was only possible to see in the room where it was actually hanging. Now its image, or a detail of it, or the image of any other painting which is reproduced, can be seen in a million different places at the same time. As you look at them now, on your screen, your wallpaper is round them, your window is opposite them, your carpet is below them. At this same moment, they are on many other screens, surrounded by different objects, different colors, different sounds. You are seeing them in the context of your own life. They are surrounded not by gilt frames, but by the familiarity of the room you are in and the people around you. Once, all these paintings belonged to their own place. Some were altarpieces in churches. Originally, paintings were an integral part of the building for which they were designed. Sometimes, when you go into a Renaissance church or chapel, you have the feeling that the images on the wall are records of the building's interior life. Together, they make up the building's memory. So much are they part of the life and individuality of the building. everything around the image is part of its meaning. Its uniqueness is part of the uniqueness of the single place where it is. Everything around it confirms and consolidates its meaning. The extreme example is the icon. Worshippers converge upon it. Behind its image is God. Before it, believers close their eyes. They do not need to go on looking at it. They know that it marks the place of meaning. Now, it belongs to no place. And you can see such an icon in your home. The images come to you. You do not go to them. The days of pilgrimage are over. It is the image of the painting which travels now, just as the image of me standing here in this studio travels to you and appears on your screen. The meaning of a painting no longer resides in its unique painted surface, which it is only possible to see in one place at one time. Its meaning, or a large part of it, has become transmittable. It comes to you, this meaning, like the news of an event. It has become information of a sort. The faces of paintings become messages, pieces of information to be used, even used to persuade us to help purchase more of the originals, which these very reproductions have in many ways replaced. But, you may say, original paintings are still unique. They look different from how they look on the television screen or on postcards. Reproductions distort. Only a few facsimiles don't. Take this original painting in the National Gallery. Only what you are seeing is still not the original. I'm in front of it. I can see it. This painting by Leonardo is unlike any other in the world. The National Gallery has the real one. It isn't a fake. It's authentic. If I go to the National Gallery and look at this painting, somehow I should be able to feel this authenticity. The Virgin of the Rocks by Leonardo da Vinci. It is beautiful for that alone. Nearly everything that we learn or read about art encourages an attitude, an expectation, rather like that. The National Gallery catalogue is for art experts. The entry on this painting is about 14 pages long, densely written. They are about who commissioned the painting, legal squabbles, who owned it, its likely date, the pedigree of its owners. Behind this information lie years of research. What for? To prove beyond any shadow of doubt that it is a genuine Leonardo, and to prove that an almost identical painting in the Louvre is in fact a replica. French art historians try to prove the opposite. For this drawing by Leonardo, the Americans wanted to pay £2.5 million. Now, it hangs in a room by itself, like a chapel, behind bulletproof perspex. The lights are kept low so as to prevent the drawing from fading. But why is it so important to preserve and display this drawing? It's acquired a kind of new impressiveness, but not because of what it shows, not because of the meaning of its image. It's become mysterious again because of its market value. And this market value depends upon it being genuine. And now it is here like a relic in a holy shrine. I don't want to suggest that there is nothing left to experience before original works of art, except a certain sense of awe because they have survived, because they're genuine, because they are absurdly valuable. A lot more is possible. But only if art is stripped of the false mystery and the false religiosity which surrounds it. This religiosity, usually linked with cash value, but always invoked in the name of culture and civilization, is in fact a substitute for what paintings lost when the camera made them reproducible. The National Gallery sell more reproductions of this Leonardo cartoon than of any other picture. But what are the meanings these reproductions acquire in each home when they're hung or pinned to the wall? And how different are all these meanings from its original one, when Leonardo first worked on it to work out an idea for a painting? The camera, by making the work of art transmittable, has multiplied its possible meanings and destroyed its unique original meaning. Have works of art gained anything by this? They have lost and gained. Let me try to explain how. The most important thing about paintings themselves is that their images are silent, still. I can't demonstrate the stillness, for the lines on your screen are never still. And in a sense, the pages of a book are never still. But I can demonstrate the silence. Occasionally, this uninterrupted silence and the stillness of a painting can be very striking. The experience of this has almost nothing to do with what anybody teaches about art. It's as if the painting, absolutely still, soundless, becomes a corridor connecting the moment it represents with the moment at which you are looking at it. And something travels down that corridor at a speed greater than light, throwing into question our way of measuring time itself. Because paintings are silent and still, and because their meaning is no longer attached to them, but has become transmittable, paintings lend themselves to easy manipulation. They can be used to make arguments or points which may be different, very different, from their original meaning. And because paintings are essentially silent and still, the most obvious way of manipulating them is by using movement and sound. The camera moves in to remove a detail of a painting from the whole. Its meaning changes. An allegorical figure becomes a pretty girl anywhere. From being part of a strange poetical world of metamorphosis, a dog can be turned into a pet, not unlike the dog of his master's voice. The meaning of a painting shown on film or television can be changed even more radically. This is a painting by Bruegel, or rather a reproduction of a painting by Bruegel, of The Road to Calvary. If you look at the whole painting, Bruegel's intention is fairly clear. In the right foreground are Mary and John and the mourners of Christ. Christ carrying the cross is in the middle distance, carried forward by the crowd, which is making its way to the place of the crucifixes, far away on the right, where a circle of onlookers has already gathered. If you look at the whole picture, you see that it is about grief, about torture, and above all about the callousness, the eager inquisitiveness, the superstitious drive of the crowd. If it sets out to be a religious painting, it is an oddly secular one. But the difficulty is that on a screen, if you keep the whole painting in view, you don't see very much. You have been waiting impatiently for the camera to go in to examine details. Yet, as soon as this happens, the comprehensive effect of the painting can be changed. For example, it is possible to isolate and show the details in a way that makes the painting look like a fairly straightforward devotional picture. With a different camera movement again, it can be shown as an example of landscape painting. Or details can present it to you in terms of the history of costume or social customs. Most easily, it can be presented as a story. The two thieves being carted to the place of crucifixion, Christ carrying the cross. In a film sequence, the details have to be selected and rearranged into a narrative which depends on unfolding time. Yet, in the painting as a whole, all these elements are there simultaneously. In paintings, there is no unfolding time. As well as by the movements of the camera, paintings are modified and changed by the sounds you hear when looking at them. Here is a landscape, a cornfield with birds flying out of it. Look at it for a moment in silence. Now, supposing I say whilst you look at it, this is the last picture Van Gogh painted before he killed himself. Words you notice consciously. Music is subtler. It can work almost without your noticing it. How often do you consciously notice the music played over paintings on television? Yet music and rhythm change the significance of a picture. Here's a painting by Caravaggio. Here are details of this painting cut to music from an Italian opera.
No so qua la far. Mandela ai parenti
per farmi smatar.
Mandela in campagna
in l'erba la magna.
Anche che parla
se come il deserto voler predicar.
Sergei abiti, sergei abiti, sergei abiti,
sergei abiti, sergei abiti,
sergei abiti, sergei abiti,
sergei abiti, ho provato tutto, niente se fa, niente se fa.
Now cut to a religious chorale. I've said that as soon as the meaning of a painting becomes transmittable, this meaning is liable to be manipulated and transformed. It's no longer a constant. It's changed by the camera which moves, by words put around it, by music played over it. Now, lastly, paintings can be changed in another way. When paintings are reproduced, they become a form of information which is being continually transmitted, and so there they have to hold their own against all the other information which is jostling around them to appear on the same page or the same screen. The meaning of an image can be changed according to what you see beside it or what comes after it. Let's try a last experiment. We put the image of this well-known painting by Goya on your screen. You look at it in the context of what I'm saying, in the context of my image in relation to it. But supposing you had just turned onto this channel from one of the other two, then you might see something like this.
Some years ago, up in the mountains that were wide.
And supposing now you turn off from our channel onto one of the others. Each time, the impact of the Goya is modified. I've now emphasized the ways in which reproduction makes the meaning of works of art ambiguous. This is not as negative as it necessarily sounds, if we realize what is happening. What it means, in theory, is that reproduction of works of art can be used by anybody for their own purposes. Images can be used like words. We can talk with them. Reproduction should make it easier to connect our experience of art directly with other experiences. You can sometimes see how naturally this begins to happen when, for instance, children or adults pin up reproductions alongside snapshots or their own drawings or pages from magazines. There, everything belongs to the same visual language, used for describing or recreating experience. What so often inhibits such a spontaneous process is the false mystification which surrounds art. For instance, the art book depends upon reproductions. Yet often, what the reproductions make accessible, a text begins to make inaccessible. What might become part of our language is jealously guarded and kept within the narrow preserves of the art expert. These last two great paintings by Franz Hals portray the governors and the governesses of an almshouse for old paupers in the Dutch 17th century city of Haarlem. Hals, an old man of over 80, was destitute. Most of his life he had been in debt. During the winter of 1664, the year he began painting these pictures, he obtained 3 loads of peat on public charity. Otherwise, he would have frozen to death. Here, he paints the official portraits of the administrators of such public charity. Reproductions in color or in black and white, showing the whole or showing details, make these two paintings easily accessible. Yet this is how these images are introduced.
Each woman stands out with equal clarity against the enormous dark surface, yet they are linked by a firm rhythmical arrangement and the subdued diagonal pattern formed by their heads and hands. Subtle modulations of the deep, glowing blacks contribute to the harmonious fusion of the whole and form an unforgettable contrast with the powerful whites and vivid flesh tones, where the detached strokes reach a peak of breadth and strength. In the portrait of the men, Hals's old tendency of creating an impression of casual informality and the instantaneousness recurs. But the pictorial unity appears less successful than in earlier works. The intense light areas of the flesh tones, the great expanses of white linen, and the daringly broad red touch on the knee of the man on the right tend to jump and are not fully integrated into a coherent design.
That is a quotation from the most comprehensive book on Hals in English. It was published last year. It's as though the author wants to mask the images, as though he fears their directness and accessibility.
As in so many other pictures by Hals, the penetrating characterizations almost seduce us into believing that we know the personality traits and even the habits of the men and women portrayed. And in the case of some critics, the seduction has been a total success.
He speaks of seduction disparagingly. Yet what is this seduction? It's nothing less than the painting working on us. If the characterization is, as he says, penetrating, it penetrates to reveal something. It's as though he doesn't want us to make sense of it in our terms. And when he sums up, he resorts to meaningless generalizations.
We attempt to control the powerful impact his paintings make upon us by considering the tradition in which he worked and the range of possibilities open to him. The effort only increases our admiration for Hals's unwavering commitment to his personal vision, which enriches our consciousness of our fellow men and heightens our awe for the ever-increasing power of the mighty impulses that enabled him to give us a close view of life's vital forces.
This is mystification. Children, until they are educated out of it and are forced to accept the mystifications, look at images and interpret them very directly. They connect any image, whether from a comic or from the National Gallery, directly with their own experience. I showed a reproduction of the Caravaggio to a group of school children.
I think it could have been they stole the food. One of them saying, "I'm not going to eat it, it's stolen food."
And he's going, "Why not?"
Something like that.
You think he wants to get up?
Yeah.
He looks as if he's a bit
just about to pass the table.
He's all romantic and she wants to go away and do something.
It might be Jesus.
What makes you think it might be Jesus?
Well, he's in the center of the table and he looks like he might be a leader of some kind.
Looks like a sheep to me.
And they've got the food on the table there.
They haven't got bread or wine.
Yes.
What do the rest of you think about him saying that it might be Jesus?
I don't think it's Jesus.
He's got his own opinion.
Could be.
Some of you think it's a man, and some of you think it's a woman.
I think it's a woman.
You can tell.
Because
she's got
too fat
to be
a man.
It looks as though they're all going to jump out and kiss her, because like, she just sits up. And he's got his arm out to cuddle her, and he's jumping up and run around.
I think it's a man.
I think it's a woman.
It is a woman. There's no bristles even.
Yes, but he hasn't got any bristles.
He got a moustache.
Yes, but he hasn't got any bristles.
Not quite all, but most of the boys thought that he was a man, and most of the girls, you thought she was a woman.
I'm not sure.
And you said she was perhaps both.
Because they were really looking and really relating what they saw to their own experience, they recognized something that most adults wouldn't. Without knowing the artist's name, let alone anything about Caravaggio's life, or the fact that he was a homosexual, they immediately saw how sexually ambivalent the principal figure was. I can't pretend to the clairvoyance of children, but in the next three programs, I'm going to try to relate the experience of art directly to other experiences and to use the means of reproduction as though they offered a language, as though pictures were like words rather than holy relics. How we see women, possessions, advertisements and their promises which surround us on every side. But remember that I am controlling and using for my own purposes the means of reproduction needed for these programs. The images may be like words, but there is no dialogue yet. You cannot reply to me. For that to become possible in the modern media of communication, access to television must be extended beyond its present narrow limits. Meanwhile, with this program, as with all programs, you receive images and meanings which are arranged. I hope you will consider what I arrange, but be skeptical of it.
And Ways of Seeing is right back here tomorrow night at 7:30. Next tonight, we've a whole stack of monitors for you, beginning with a chat with one of the most iconic film directors and actors of all time.
Welcome to the world.
Men dream of women. Women dream of themselves being dreamt of. Men look at women. Women watch themselves being looked at. Women constantly meet glances which act like mirrors, reminding them of how they look or how they should look. Behind every glance is a judgment. Sometimes the glance they meet is their own, reflected back from a real mirror. A woman is always accompanied, except when quite alone, perhaps even then, by her own image of herself. While she is walking across a room or weeping at the death of her father, she cannot avoid envisaging herself walking or weeping. From earliest childhood, she is taught and persuaded to survey herself continually. She has to survey everything she is and everything she does, because how she appears to others, and particularly how she appears to men, is of crucial importance for what is normally thought of as the success of her life. A woman in the culture of privileged Europeans is first and foremost a sight to be looked at. What kind of sight is revealed in the average European oil painting? There were portraits of women as there were portraits of men, but in one category of painting, women were the principal, ever-recurring subject. That category was the nude. In the nudes of European painting, we can discover some of the criteria and conventions by which women were judged. We can see how women were seen. What then is a nude? In his book on the nude, Kenneth Clark says that being naked is simply being without clothes. The nude, according to him, is a form of art. I would put it differently. To be naked is to be oneself. To be nude is to be seen naked by others and yet not recognized for oneself. A nude has to be seen as an object in order to be a nude. In the European oil painting, nakedness is not taken for granted as in archaic art. Nakedness is a sight for those who are dressed. That is why Manet's painting, which really marks the end of the period I'm considering, is so profound a comment on all the works which preceded it. The story begins with the story of Adam and Eve as told in Genesis. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat. And she gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And the Lord God called unto the man and said unto him, Where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. Unto the woman God said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. Two things are striking about this story. They become aware of being naked, because as a result of eating the apple, Each sees the other differently. Nakedness is created in the mind of the beholder. The second striking fact is that the woman is blamed and is punished by being made subservient to the man. In relation to the woman, the man becomes the agent of God. In medieval art, the story is often illustrated scene following scene, as in a strip cartoon. During the Renaissance, the narrative sequence disappears, and the single moment, which is nearly always depicted, is the moment of shame. The couple wear fig leaves or make a modest gesture with their hands. But now, their shame is not so much in relation to one another as to the spectator. It is the spectator's looking which shames them. Later, as painting became more secular, many other subjects offered the opportunity of painting nudes. But always in the European tradition, the nude implies an awareness of being seen by the spectator. They are not naked as they are. They are naked as you see them. Often, as with the favorite subject of Susanna and the Elders, this is the actual theme of the picture. We join the elders to spy on her. She looks back at us looking at her. Sometimes the woman, Susanna, looks at herself in a mirror, picturing to herself how men see her. She sees herself first and foremost as a sight, which means a sight for men. Thus, the mirror became a symbol of the vanity of women. Yet the male hypocrisy in this is blatant. You paint a naked woman because you enjoy looking at her. You put a mirror in her hand, and you call the painting vanity, thus morally condemning the woman whose nakedness you have depicted for your own pleasure, and thus, incidentally, repeating the biblical example by blaming the woman. The judgment of Paris was another favorite mythological subject with the same inwritten idea of men looking at naked women and judging them. Paris awards the apple to the woman he finds most beautiful. Beauty in this context is bound to become competitive. The judgment of Paris is transformed into the beauty contest. Aesthetics, when applied to women, are not as disinterested as the word beauty might suggest. I don't want to deny the crucial part that seeing plays in sexuality, but there's a great difference between being seen as oneself naked or seeing another in that way and a body being put on display. To be naked is to be without disguise. To be on display is to have the surface of one's own skin, the hairs of one's own body, turned into a disguise which cannot be discarded. Amongst the tens of thousands of European oil paintings of nudes, there are perhaps 20 or 30 exceptions, paintings in which the artist has seen the woman revealed as herself. This Rubens. This Rembrandt. This Georges de la Tour. These paintings are as personal as love poems, and their character is quite distinctive. Most nudes in oil paintings have been lined up by their painters for the pleasure of the male spectator owner, who will assess and judge them as sights. Their nudity is another form of dress. They are condemned to never being naked. With their clothes off, they are as formal as with their clothes on. Those who are not judged beautiful are not beautiful. Those who are given the prize. The prize is to be owned, that is to say, to be available. Charles II commissioned this secret painting from Lely. It's like hundreds of others. It might be Venus and Cupid. But in fact, it was a portrait of one of his mistresses, Nell Gwynne. It shows her passively looking at the spectator, staring at her naked. Her nakedness is not an expression of her own feelings. It is only a sign of her submission to his demand. The painting, when he shows it to others, demonstrates this submission. His guests envy him. By contrast, in another tradition, nakedness is a celebration of active sexual love as between two people, the woman as active as the man. The actions of each absorb the other. In oil painting, the second person, or the second person who matters, is the stranger looking at the picture. Compare the expression of these two women. One the model for what is considered a masterpiece by Ang, and the other an ill-paid model for a photograph in a girly magazine. Or these two. Just the expression, the look. What do you see? It seems to me that in each pair, the expression is remarkably similar, and that it is an expression of responding with calculated charm to the man whom she knows is looking at her, although she doesn't know him. It is true that sometimes a painting includes a male lover, but the woman's attention is very rarely directed towards him. She looks away from him, or she looks out of the picture towards he who considers himself her true lover, the spectator owner. This painting was sent as a present from the Grand Duke of Florence to the King of France. The boy kneeling on the cushion and kissing the woman is Cupid. She is Venus. But the way her body is arranged has nothing to do with that kissing. Her body is arranged in the way it is to display it to the man looking at the picture. The picture is made to appeal to his sexuality. It has nothing to do with her sexuality. The convention of not painting the hair on a woman's body helps towards the same end. Hair is associated with sexual power, with passion. The woman's sexual passion needs to be minimized so that the spectator may feel that he has the monopoly of such passion. There were paintings which depicted male lovers. These did exist, but they were mostly private, semi-pornographic pictures. In most paintings, which were painted to be seen rather than hidden, the only rival to the male spectator is a Cupid. And how extraordinary it is that the pictorial symbol of passion was a small boy. For a similar reason, women in the European art of the oil painting are seldom shown dancing. They have to be shown languid, exhibiting a minimum of energy. They are there to feed an appetite, not to have any of their own. The appetite was theoretically gargantuan. The absurdity of this male flattery, although it was not seen as absurd then, reached its peak in the public academic art of the 19th century. Prime ministers discussed under paintings like this. When one of them felt he had been outwitted, he looked up for consolation. The nude in European oil painting is usually presented as an ideal subject. It is said to be an expression of the European humanist spirit. I don't want to reject entirely the truth of this, but I've tried to add to it, starting off from a different viewpoint. Dürer, who believed in the ideal nude, thought that this ideal could be constructed by taking the shoulders of one body, the hands of another, the breasts of another, and so on. Was this humanist idealism? Or was it the result of an indifference to who any one person really was? Do these paintings celebrate, as we're normally taught, the women within them, or the male voyeur? Is there sexuality within the frame or in front of it? I showed the program, as you have seen it up till now, to five women. It began to seem absurd that the only images you were seeing were of women silent, mute. So I showed it to them and asked them to comment not so much on the program, but rather on the questions raised by it. Above all, on the question of how men see women or have seen them in the past, and how this influences the way women see themselves today.
We have an image, of course we all have an image of ourselves, and it's a visual image. But I wonder how much this sort of classical European painting has shaped that image. In my own case, I find it quite impossible when I look at the paintings that you show in your film. I can't take them seriously. I cannot identify with them because they are so immensely exaggerated always. You know, they fasten on to some secondary sexual characteristic, you know, these enormous breasts and sort of great big bee sting bottoms, you know, and those huge things like that, and they just aren't real. Whereas with photographs, you can feel that is potentially, that's possibly me, although no, it probably isn't. But these nearly all the paintings you have shown are what is called idealized, and therefore they are to me very unreal in connection with any deep down image that I might have of myself, and in connection with any deep down pleasure that I might have in looking at another female body. They don't give me that kind of pleasure at all. I can admire them as painting, but they don't mean human beings to me.
The image that I compare myself with is the photograph, because it's with photographs that I've been encouraged to think of myself in this way. It is essentially advertising for me that's contributed to this. And consequently, I find it extremely interesting to go back and think of nudes in this way, because I've never done so. But having seen the film, I have no doubt that the same thing applies.
And do you find the nudes in painting unreal in the same way?
Yes.
Well, you can't get any information from it, can you? There's no guide towards the future.
I mean, what kind of information is lacking?
Oh, well, activity, you know, dynamism, anything. It is how someone sees you, and that's all. It's something laid on you.
I'm glad you showed the many picture, because I always find this extremely shocking, you know, because the men are dressed and the women are naked, and this seems to me to sum up the whole situation. It's a humiliating position, and these women are aware of being humiliated. And I think this is part of the whole scheme of things. I mean, as most people have had at some stage in their life, sort of nightmares about running through the streets with nothing on and everybody else is dressed. And this seems to me one element in the pictures.
A very interesting thing you said in the film was about how nudity was really a kind of disguise. It wasn't the real person themselves and free, but it was just another garment they were wearing, and worse than a garment in a sense, because it's something that you can't take off. This comes, I think, from nudity being combined with a pose, and that's inevitable if you're going to have a painting of a model. In a way, I think that we're always dressing up for a part, always putting on a uniform of one kind or another. And I think women do this almost more than men. Men have only begun doing it fairly recently. Women are always dressing to show the kind of character that they want to represent, the mother, the working woman, the pretty young chick. And nudity is a uniform, in a way, for I'm ready now for sexual pleasure. You see, and so it doesn't. You can't identify being nude with being free.
I've only just recently read that book Histoire d'eau, which describes the way in which a woman is reduced for the sexual pleasure of the man she's in love with to a complete object. And what struck me in all that book as the most impressive image was the fact that she was told that she was never to touch her own breasts, to entirely close her mouth, or to put her legs together. And so the whole point about her stance all the time was that she was available. And this, the sense of being available, the sense of waiting for other people, is the very antithesis of action. And it, you know, just like the whole, the Brook Street Bureau advertisement, Tony hasn't rung, you know, he's 3 minutes late and ringing. And you feel this whole situation, the number of women you talk to who say, I stay in so many nights a week waiting for somebody to ring, you know. That the concept of availability implies passivity, because if you're simply waiting for somebody else to act, then you can't act yourself.
Yes, it's like you will awake when a man taps you, you know, when a man kisses you, you will arise and get off your bed. But really it's an excuse to get yourself going. I think women are too shy. You know? They're waiting too long.
Yes, yes.
Could I say something there about narcissism? I think that both men and women are narcissistic, but in different senses. And I think that sometimes I have the impression that men and women are tremendously narcissistic and cut off from each other by their images of themselves, but that whereas a woman's image of herself is derived directly from other people, the mirror you're talking about. A man's image of himself is derived from the world. That is, it's the world that gives him back his image because he acts in it. And, you know, women are drawn to him as a source, as a centre of activity, and as a source of worth. I mean, since he is in the world, the fact that he values her is important. And so because their sort of centres of narcissism are different, and the woman's is essentially only related to the other person, she's in a much more passive position than he is in relation to it.
Yes. Do you see narcissism as essentially a negative or positive phenomenon?
Well, I think that's very difficult to answer, but in the sense that it is related to identity, it's a positive phenomenon. And it seems to me that what women envy in men a lot of the time is that they have a sense of their own identity, that there is something in them which is important to them, other than simply what other people think of them. And I think that that thing is the product of their interaction with the world, that is, other things and other people. And it's sort of, it's almost as if through this interaction they actually build up a store of worth, a sense of themselves, which is a constant. I mean, it can't be lost. But that because the woman doesn't go out and act, she doesn't create this store. She waits only for the present interaction with a man. Mm-hmm. That can just end at any moment.
There's something here that really I'd like to twist round a little bit, because narcissism is a very sort of pronounced way of stating a relationship to the world, whether it's a man or a woman, isn't it? But this other question, which is contained within it, but doesn't go as far as it as an idea, is this sort of self-delight of a person, whether it's a man or a woman, in life, in what they're doing, in their relationships with men or women. And it's a thing that matters tremendously. And it's not only a kind of inner thing by which you live, but it's a very outer thing by which you gain relationships with your own context in the world that you can't gain any other way. But it's when you have somehow been made so unconscious of yourself that you easily, naturally, sort of compulsively go out to whatever is going on around you. Now, when you're a child, that tends more than with people to be other things, doesn't it? Mountains, streams, wherever you go. And then only gradually, as you go on, you make this kind of absolutely necessary contact with people. But I do think that the sort of essence of self-delight as a kind of possible thing in the modern world, and something that fewer women have than men and want and must have, is the power, the compulsion, not the power, the compulsion to make contact with the world as you are living in it. And when I say that, I don't just mean the people next door or your friends. I simply mean what is going on.
I'm not so sure about the delight. I think it's a very double-edged thing. I know, as I suppose I've always known, but I became aware of it in this film, that I have never consciously looked at myself in the mirror and seen myself as I am. I always see the image that I want. I know, and my children notice it, that if I make up my face, I put on a certain expression. From adolescence on, if I've seen myself naked in the mirror, I have not thought of myself as naked, I have thought of myself as a nude. And I think this comes very largely from having been trailed around all the major art galleries in adolescence. You know, this is culture, this is beauty, with a capital B. And of course, up to a point from advertising too, but much more the painting thing, that you You think the female body is beautiful. I am a beautiful object. If not, I have to do something about it. And therefore, the painful part of the narcissistic thing is, I think, the feeling of inadequacy. Now, this business of always posing in a mirror, I think one does absolutely automatically, and the result is that if you actually catch yourself in a mirror by chance, that's not deliberately because you're getting dressed or something, you've had a bath, but because there's one in the street, or you catch yourself in a shop window, it's a tremendous shock because you suddenly see yourself as you are, which is windblown, untidy, badly dressed, tired, and so on. You don't see the pose at all, and I think this is what happens to women, that they're always trying to measure up to this erotic image that is projected.
There are some paintings, and I think at this moment in particular of one painting, where there's a woman who is wearing a garment. She's not nude, but it is a garment so loose, so comfortable, so easy, and it's my idea very much of what a picture of a woman might be like. I think it's actually before your period almost. It's so long ago. I mean, it's by Lorenzetti. It comes in The Good and Bad Government. It's a fresco. It's very, very old, you know, and it is a picture of a woman who is supposed to represent peace. It's quite extraordinary, but she could be one of the liberated or trying to be liberated young women today. She is at ease. She is relaxed. She is not playing any part at all. She is able to combine pleasure with thought and with dreaming, and she might spring into action at any moment. And for me, she has much, much more to do with nakedness, with oneself, with the truth about oneself, than any number of nudes that I've ever seen.
And the third part of Ways of Seeing is here at the same time tomorrow. Next tonight, Andrew Graham Dixon is at the Tate Modern for an exhibition by Max Beckman.
We look, we buy, it is ours. Ours to consume, to sell again, perhaps to give away. More often, ours to keep.
You can have that for £2.
Look at these cute little tarts.
Where's the tea for?
Tea caddy.
We look, we buy, and we collect valuable objects, but the most valuable object of all has become the oil painting. Oil paintings often depict things which in reality are buyable. To paint a thing and put it on a canvas is not unlike buying it and putting it in your house. The objects within the painting often appear as tangible as those outside it. If you buy a painting, you buy also the look of the thing it represents.
And this one?
That's £17.
Isn't this silver?
No, it's a silver plate. But mother poor hand.
Paintings often show treasures. but paintings have become treasures themselves. Art galleries are like palaces, but they are also like banks. When they shut for the night, they are guarded, lest the images of the things which are desirable are stolen. The value of paintings has become mysterious. Where, we ask ourselves, does this value come from? Those who write about art, or talk, or teach about it, often raise art above life, turning it into a kind of religion. In the first of these programs, I tried to show how and why modern methods of reproduction and communication, like color photography, like television, have theoretically changed the meaning of the visual art of the past, demystifying it and making it secular. But mostly those who use these new methods of reproduction and communication, those who write books or make television programs about art, tend to cling to the old approach. Art remains something sacred. A love of art seems automatically to be offered as a sublime human experience. Perhaps, though, we should consider this historical record. Two films of two concerts given in Britain and Germany during the last war. Both films made as war propaganda to engender pride in the national cultural heritage. The first shows a concert in London given by Myra Hess. The second shows a concert in Berlin by Furtwängler. If the experience of art is sublime, it looks as though it can be sublimely independent of a lot of other values. So perhaps we should be somewhat wary of a love of art. You cannot explain anything in history, not even in art history, by a love of art. Let us look at a painting whose subject is an art lover. This picture, which shows a 17th century patron surrounded by his collection, tells us more about Europe and painting from the Renaissance onwards than hundreds of art books or essays on aesthetics. What does it show? The sort of man for whom painters painted their paintings. What are these paintings? Before they are anything else, they are objects which can be bought and owned. Unique objects. A patron cannot be surrounded by music or poems in the same way as he is surrounded by his pictures. Does this special ownership of pictures engender a special kind of pride? It is as though he lives in a house built of paintings. What is their advantage over walls of stone or wood? They show him sights. There are many different subjects, but what the pictures all have in common is that they are painted with oil paint. From about 1500 to 1900, the visual arts of Europe were dominated by the oil painting, the easel picture. This kind of painting had never been used anywhere else in the world before. The tradition of oil painting was made up of hundreds of thousands of unremarkable works, hung all over the walls of galleries and private houses, rather in the same way as the reserve collection is still hung in the National Gallery. If, as we are normally taught to do, we emphasize the genius of the few and concentrate only on the exceptional works, we will misunderstand what the tradition was really about. European oil painting, unlike the art of other civilizations and periods, placed a unique emphasis on the tangibility, the solidity, the texture, the weight, the graspability of what was depicted. What was real was what you could put your hands on. The idea that a thing is only real if you can pick it up may be connected with the idea of taking a thing to pieces to see how it works. At the beginning of the tradition of oil painting, the emphasis on the real being solid was part of a scientific attitude. But the emphasis on the real being solid, on being what you could put your hands on, became equally closely connected with a sense of ownership. These scientific instruments were used for navigation. They were painted at the time when the world trade routes to Europe were being opened up by the heroic voyages which we learnt about in school, bringing European civilization to the rest of the world. It tends to be forgotten that these voyages were the start of the European slave trade and the traffic which began to siphon the riches of the rest of the world into Europe. Christopher Columbus wrote from Jamaica, "Gold is a wonderful thing. By means of gold, one can even get souls into paradise." In 1519, Magellan set out to sail round the world. He and an astronomer friend with whom he had planned the voyage were to keep 20% of the profits made and the right to run the government of any land they discovered and conquered. This globe charts Magellan's voyage round the world. Beside it is a book of arithmetic, a hymn book, and a lute. To conquer a land, it was always necessary to convert it to Christianity. The picture was painted in 1533 by Holbein. It shows two French diplomats in London. The picture is about science, about navigation, about diplomacy, about power. But in the way that it has been painted, in the way that it has been seen, what is it most about? There is not a surface in this picture which does not denote wealth. There is not a surface which has not been elaborately and skillfully worked. Except for their faces and hands, every square inch of the canvas has been gone over numerous times by weavers, embroiderers, carpet makers, mosaic makers, leather workers, farriers, jewelers, and last of all, by Holbein the painter. They are two men convinced that the world is there to furnish their residence in it. The seafaring instruments have been placed on an eastern carpet. Without the first, the second would not be there. Implicit in the rise of European Christian culture was the destruction of other cultures. But the Europeans saw it differently. They believed that their civilization was in all respects more advanced than any other. The African kneels to hold up an oil painting to his master. The painting he is holding depicts the castle above one of the principal centers of the West African slave trade. Many works of art in other cultures and periods have celebrated wealth and power. Gods, princes, and dynasties were worshipped. But these works were static, ritualistic, hierarchic, symbolic. They celebrated a social or divine order. The European oil painting served a different kind of wealth. It glorified not a static order of things, but the ability to buy and furnish and to own. Before the invention of oil painting, medieval European painters often used gold leaf in their pictures. Afterwards, gold disappeared from their paintings and was only used for their frames. But sometimes the paintings themselves were simple demonstrations of what gold, of what money could buy. A certain kind of oil painting celebrated merchandise in a way that had never happened before in the history of art. Merchandise became the actual principal subject of these works. Eating is a pleasure, but these paintings cannot be eaten. They are a demonstration of something else. First of all, of the artist's virtuosity. Secondly, of the owner's wealth. Livestock. Not animals in their natural condition, but animals whose pedigree is emphasized and whose pedigree is a proof of their value, whose pedigree emphasizes the social pedigree of their owners. They are painted like pieces of furniture, a table or chair with four legs. Objects. Objects which, significantly enough, became known as objets d'art. Houses. Buildings not considered as ideal works of architecture, as in the work of some of the earlier Renaissance artists, but buildings considered as landed property. Portraits were equally important. Portraits of the owners of the paintings, and the owners of much else besides. These paintings did not directly celebrate what was buyable. They were records of the confidence of those to whom ownership brought confidence. Those who could buy banquets, horses, bulls, houses, hung on their walls generations of portraits painted to celebrate a continuity of power and worthiness. There were hundreds of thousands of such portraits, but those they depicted represented an exceedingly small fraction of the population. The poor have neither annals nor portraits. Their lives are unrecorded. But again, the style with which the average portrait was painted reveals something about the basis of this confidence and of this so-called dignity of the sitter. They were painted as though they were a strange mixture of livestock, furniture, and tailor's dummies. Every portrait is a record which says, I once existed and looked like this. These portraits say, in addition, I was an object of respect and envy. I had only to raise my hand to receive attention. Everybody's clothes indicate social status, but the clothes and feathers and jewelry of these women make exaggerated claims. It is their clothes, not their faces, which dazzle. The faces of women in many European paintings are like the faces of swimmers in seas of silk and satin. Oil painting could paint these materials as they had never before been painted. There were also paintings whose subjects were taken from classical literature, subjects which today seem quite remote, unsubstantial, dreamlike. But this wasn't so when the pictures were bought. Classical mythology was part of the specialized knowledge of the privileged minority. And these paintings helped them to visualize themselves whilst displaying the classic virtues, making the classic gestures. The paintings were the settings for charades in which they themselves would play. The props were given, the spirit of the performance was left to the owner's imagination. The figures were like garments held out for the spectator owners to put their arms into and wear. Here, the daughters of the family dress up as graces decorating Hymen. But the dressing up didn't have to be as literal as that. The spectator wore the clothes and played his part just in imagination. Who would you guess she was meant to represent? Different painters see her differently. But do these paintings have anything in common? And if so, what is it that they all convey? These pictures are all from the National Gallery and are all of Mary Magdalene. The point of the original story is that a prostitute so loves Christ that she repents of her past and comes to accept the mortality of flesh and the immortality of the soul. In each case, the way the picture is painted contradicts the essence of the story. The method of painting, the way of seeing, can only envisage her as being, before everything else, takeable. The hypocrisy is sexual. The title suggests sacred love. The painting, with title as alibi, speaks of profane love. Alternatively, she is simply a well-dressed, eligible young woman. The tangibility of her wardrobe, the elegance of her presence is all. It's a portrait that might have been painted of her for her future husband on the occasion of their betrothal. What I'm saying applies least of all to landscape painting or to the great late masters of landscape painting like Constable or Turner or Monet. But even there, in the development of landscape painting, the faculty of oil painting to celebrate property did play a certain role. This is what Sir Kenneth Clark says about Gainsborough.
At the very beginning of his career, his pleasure in what he saw inspired him to put into his pictures backgrounds as sensitively observed as the cornfield in which are seated Mr. and Mrs. Andrews. This enchanting work is painted with such love and mastery that we should have expected Gainsborough to go further in the same direction. But he gave up direct painting and evolved the melodious style of picture making by which he is best known.
Now look at it another way. The way I would use it for my argument. They have become not a couple in nature as Rousseau imagined nature. Theirs is private land. Look at their attitude towards it. The attitude is visible. If a man stole a potato at that time, he risked a public whipping. The sentence for poaching was deportation. Without doubt, among the principal pleasures this painting gave to Mr. and Mrs. Andrews was the pleasure of seeing themselves as the owners of their own land. And this pleasure was enhanced by the ability of oil paint to render this land in all its substantiality. The surrealist painter Magritte commented on this faculty of oil painting. The painted landscape stands in for the real one. A number of great painters used oil paint to express their own highly personal and exceptional visions. They, in many ways, contradict my argument. They also contradict the tradition from which they sprang. This picture by Rubens celebrates the park and farmland surrounding the chateau he lived in. But the chateau and its owners are far away. Hunting is free. The fields are golden. The landscape is like a counterpane on a bed. It is a painting which goes beyond its traditional category. It is not a painting about a castle and its lands. On the contrary, it shows a world without scarcity, a world of plenty, a world, that is, which contradicts the entire history of private property. There's a painting of a woman by Vermeer, which at first sight confirms everything I have said. It would seem to be the ideal illustration of my argument. She is weighing gold in a pair of scales, or perhaps also weighing the pearls strewn on the table. Her interest is commercial. In the way the scene is painted, the substantiality and tangibility of everything is emphasized. Everything suggests the solidity of a Dutch middle-class home, even the painting of the Last Judgment on the wall behind her. A painting on the wall is a mark of prosperity. But go on looking. Gradually, the painting becomes more mysterious, less easily explainable in my terms. The light falls on her face, on her fingers, on the scales, on the pearls. The moment has been preserved. And as we realize that, the way that it has been preserved, we realize that, like every moment, it was unrepeatable. It is as though she is holding the moment between her forefinger and thumb on the scales of the past and the future. Despite its apparent celebration of property, this painting is about the mystery of light and time as we look up at the stars. Not for one moment would I deny or belittle the significance and achievement of paintings like these. But we should not confuse these exceptional paintings, and everything in the museums, everything said by art experts, encourages this confusion. We should not confuse such exceptional works with the purpose and significance of the general tradition. Let me show the difference again, this time at the highest level. Two self-portraits by Rembrandt. One when he was young, one when he was old. But the difference between them isn't just a question of how age changes a man's character. In the first painting, Rembrandt used the style and methods of the tradition for their traditional purposes, as an advertisement for the owner's good fortune, prestige, and wealth. In the later painting, he has turned the tradition against itself. All has gone, except a sense of the question of existence as a question. Intermittently, the tradition can breed within itself a counter-tradition. But the basic values of the tradition win in the end. This painting now has a fabulous price on its head, perhaps £3 million. It has itself become a fabulous object of property. Of course, a lot more can be said about European oil painting than I have said. Yet what I have tried to show is a fundamental part of the truth which is usually ignored. We study other cultures far away as anthropology. That's to say, we study them from the outside and judge them purely according to their own explanations of themselves. Now, if we look at the culture of the European oil painting in the same spirit, leaving aside its own claims for itself, I believe we will find that oil painting was, before everything else, a medium which celebrated private possessions. The tradition of the oil painting has now been broken once and for all. In some ways, publicity has taken its place. The sight of it makes us want to possess it. Publicity is the subject of our program next week.
And the final part of Ways of Seeing is right here on BBC Four tomorrow at 7:30. Next tonight, stay with us as we prowl through wild China.
In our urban world, in the streets where we walk, in the buses we take, in the magazines we read, on walls, on screens, we are surrounded by images of an alternative way of life. We may remember or forget these images, but briefly we take them in. And for a moment they stimulate our imagination, either by way of memory or anticipation. But where is this other way of life? It's a language of words and images, which calls out to us wherever we go, whatever we read, wherever we are. Where do they exist, these fabulous rewards and objects and people? Where do they belong to? Here, there, or nowhere? They come with us everywhere. We take them away in our minds. We see them in our dreams. Publicity proposes to each of us in a consumer society that we change ourselves or our lives by buying something more. This more, publicity persuades us, will make us in some way richer, even though we will be poorer by having spent our money. And publicity persuades us of this transformation by showing us people who have apparently been transformed and are, as a result, enviable. This state of being envied is what constitutes glamour. And publicity is the process of manufacturing glamour.
Come forward more.
Glamour is supposed to go deeper than looks, but it depends upon them utterly. Glamour works through the eye and the mirror.
Oh yes, this is all over lovely daughters. All over, I'm not a professional hairdresser. Can you get the tangle out?
Glamour is for everybody who believes they can be glamorous, or perhaps more accurately, for everybody who finds that they cannot afford not to be glamorous.
Yes, keep the fringes free, Oliver.
The setting in which glamour is here being created is an old one, a large country house now turned into a public park. These parklands and trees were once laid out in the same spirit as the landscapes in oil paintings, in which idealized nymphs and goddesses played.
They're trying to make it look like three flowers in the trees. Come in a little bit more. Can you, no, you stay there. That's nice.
Now, the model has taken the place of the goddess. Yet glamour is a new idea. For those who once lived in the country houses and owned the classical oil paintings, the idea of glamour did not exist. Ideas of grace, elegance, authority amounted to something apparently similar, but fundamentally very different. When everybody's place in society is more or less determined by birth, personal envy is a less familiar emotion. And without social envy, glamour cannot exist. Envy becomes a common emotion in a society which has moved towards democracy and then stopped halfway, where status is theoretically open to everyone, but enjoyed by only a few. Glamour is new. Society has changed. But the oil painting and the publicity image have much in common. And we only fail to see this because we think of one as fine art and the other as commerce. Sometimes publicity impersonates a painting. Boys are posed to match the boyhood of Raleigh. Real people pose, like the figures in Manet's Déjeuner sur l'herbe. A man dresses up to look like a portrait by Hulse. Sometimes works of art are used to give prestige to a publicity scene. A doodle by Michelangelo. A painting by Rubens. A painting by Dürer. A whole sea by Hokusai. Usually the references to art are less direct. It is a question of publicity echoing devices once used in oil painting, devices of atmosphere. Settings. Pleasures. Objects. Poses. Symbols of prestige. Gestures. Signs of love. Oil painting, as I tried to show last week, was a medium especially developed in order to render on canvas the physical texture and tangibility of things. Today, color photography performs a similar role. Color photography, oil paint. Publicity and oil painting use many of the same references and celebrate the same qualities in things, share many of the same ideals, all of them related to the principle that you are what you have. Their purpose and their effects, however, are very different. The oil painting showed what the owner was already enjoying among his possessions and his way of life. It consolidated his own sense of his own value. It enhanced his view of himself as he already was. It began with facts, the facts of his life. Of course, there were other facts which it didn't take into account. Where did the owner's wealth come from? The exploitation on which his wealth was based was not shown. But what was shown did at least correspond to the condition of his own life. Publicity is different. It appeals to a way of life we aspire to, or think we aspire to, but have not yet achieved. A publicity picture suggests that if we buy what it is offering, our life will be different from what it is. Scene after scene shows you this different life. Not only will our home be different, but all our relationships will become radiant because of our new possessions. But we can only achieve such radiance if we have money. And so publicity also works on our anxieties about money. Urging each of us to scramble competitively to get more. Making money appear as if it were itself magical. This may persuade a few people to use a bank credit system despite the very high rate of interest. But what is more important is that it promotes the illusion that a man's ability to consume is directly related to his sexual virility. According to the rules of the dream, those who do not have this power, those who lack glamour, become faceless, almost non-existent. Publicity both promises and threatens. It plays upon fear, often the fear of not being desirable, of being unenviable. It suggests that you are inadequate as you are, but it consoles you with the promise of a dream. Behind the dream are the working lives of the very people it addresses. With this spray, you will be wanted. Meanwhile, there is the present of the women who manufacture such sprays. Future deferred. Meanwhile, the interminable present. The more monotonous the present, the more the imagination must seize upon the future. The passivity of the present is then replaced by the activity of an imaginary future, the pictures conjured up by publicity. The imagery may be public, but the dreams are intimate. Here are three such dreams. The dream of later tonight. You are part of the good life they smile at. They are part of the good life you smile at. Everyone is surrounded by what brings pleasure, but it is you who will bring the greatest pleasure of all. Next morning, you'll still feel the same about it. The skin dream. The surface you can touch. The skin without a biography. Dream of a faraway place, to lie down on a bed alone, to allow one's thoughts to pass through the light of the window, to travel elsewhere, conjuring images. Distances without horizons. To be in two worlds at the same time, just where Europe ends. The other world, violent, infidel, full of unknown passions. Wearing your own clothes next to your own skin, you join the nomads. Go north to ancient castles, an age of chivalry, of romantic love. It is dawn. You are innocent, you are pure, you are ready to travel again. Publicity works on the imagination, but it does something else too. Because publicity pretends to interpret the world around us and to explain everything in its own terms, publicity adds up to a kind of philosophical system. The things which publicity sells are in themselves neutral, just objects. And so they have to be made glamorous by being inserted into contexts which are exotic enough to be arresting, but not close enough to us to offer a threat. A machine gun can support shoes. Revolution can be wrapped around anything. In this way, publicity abuses the realities of public figures and events and struggles in other parts of the world. Sometimes this reality and this unreality confront each other, and then we are faced by a contrast which is incomprehensible. Look, I open a copy of the Sunday Times color magazine. Aramis is an attitude. It is not merely proposing a new shaving soap. It is proposing, as it says, an attitude, a life, a civilization. The highest value of this civilization is the individual ego. Pimm's tastes every bit as good as it looks and is easy to drink, which is sometimes hard for us to live with, because we wouldn't want people to think the chords it strikes are all meek and mild-mannered. So, when you're through with your first half pint of Pimm's, stand back and see how you look, and face the hard truth. That song may have ended, but the melody is lingering on. I turn the page. These are photographs of refugees from East Pakistan fled to West Bengal. Text, which accompanies the photographs, says that these refugees deserve more help than any others in the world. The writer appeals to the public conscience. But if I turn the page again, the inadequacy of such appeals becomes obvious. The words and pictures on these pages all appear to be real and all belong to the same language. The text, the photographs taken in Pakistan, the photographs taken for the publicity, the editing of the paper, the layout, the printing, all are elements of the same culture, our culture. Yet between each page, there is such a fissure, such a disconnection, such incoherence, that one can only say this culture is mad. On pages like these, reality itself becomes unrecognizable. It is difficult in this clamor to explain why one set of victims deserves more attention and more help than any others. There have been so many refugees in recent years. Aperitifs can be a bit sweet for today's taste, so a lot of people go to the other extreme and serve dry drinks that taste of nothing. What do words mean when juxtaposed like this? What happens in East Pakistan, or for that matter Birmingham, any historic event anywhere, is always on the far side of the frontier of the publicity dream. What happens out there happens to strangers whose fate is meant to be different from ours. What happens in the dream is meant to happen to us. Things happen after a Bodhidas bath. There is no communication between the two worlds. Their contrast is beyond understanding, unless one takes a world political view. Yet, what is really the connection between these publicity images and our own lives, between their promises and our own needs? Why, eventually, are these publicity images so bleak? what surrounds these posters. Oil paintings were surrounded by gold frames, which symbolized the wealth of the owner within the picture and around it. What surrounds the publicity image is us as we are. Our cities are papered with pictures of what we might buy, papered with dreams which invite us to enter them. But they exclude us as we now are. Behind the paper are hidden our needs. This series began by considering the tradition of the European oil painting. It has ended by us looking at publicity images today, because I believe that in many respects, these images continue that tradition. I have been critical of many things in that tradition, of our culture, of some of the values which it celebrates. And I've illustrated my arguments by using the modern means of reproduction. But finally, what I've shown and what I have said, like everything else that is shown or said through these means of reproduction, must be judged against your own experience.
The final part of The Art of Arts TV is here at 10 tonight on BBC4. But next tonight, more art as Andrew Graham Dixon takes us on a tour of British art.